Hello, and welcome to Foot the Bill, where we audit your favorite media. My name is Trey, and we figured we're deep enough into this show now that we should probably have a formal introduction. Hey, how's it going? You doing all right? So, you may be asking yourself, why have I watched every Foot the Bill but not subscribed yet? Am I a criminal? You might be. But I'll testify on your behalf to the contrary if you subscribe right now. Did you do it? You wouldn't lie to me, would you? Of course not, because you're not a criminal. Unlike John Kramer, Jigsaw, finally really dead. Last time we saw John, he was playing Rock, Paper, Saw with Jeff the Unforgiving. Everyone lost. But the game's not over. There's still 16 more movies to this franchise we haven't covered yet, which means there's a chance Jigsaw's bills could get even more outrageous. Can a corpse accrue debt? Will his estate pay for the next generation of deadly shenanigans? Are we finally going to post a graph at the end of the video comparing the first saga of the franchise? As always, there are rules.
It's the rules.
No utilities get charged. Water, electric, gas, you get it. Purchases are calculated in the year depicted in the media we're analyzing. For Saw 4, this means 2006. Like before, I'll permit location-specific scavenging and foraging. If it doesn't fit, though, it gets billed. And here's something new. We're including known locations in the timeline as scavenging points now. Saw 3 saw the use of the meatpacking plant, and a lot of supplies were pulled from that location. At the same time, we're now past the chronological point of the Saw video games, which, according to multiple sources, are canon, and these take place in an asylum. This will make more sense when we get into the thick of things. However, if a location becomes compromised by police, it is no longer viable for scavenging. This is why we don't recycle certain guns, VHS tapes, microcassettes, or billies. They're police evidence, not torture hand-me-downs. Speaking of hand-me-downs, it sounds like Jigsaw's about ready to hand down his legacy. Can his estate survive the cost of Saw 4? Let's find out. We begin the movie with the body of John. He might still be alive, though. Maybe he'll... Oop, nope, he's very dead. Well, we charged for that cassette tape previously, and I think that's Detective Hoffman's personal microcassette recorder, so we'll let it slide. This time. The ghost of Jigsaw tells us the game's not over.
You think it's over just because I'm dead? It's not over. The games have just begun.
And we burst into the first trap of the film. The mausoleum. Or as I call it, the Lady and the Tramp. Our victims are collared to what is best described as a large winch in the middle of the cemetery mausoleum. Baldy has his eyes sewn shut, while Curly has his mouth sewn shut. On the back of each other's necks is the key to each other's respective collars. Upon playing too rough in their game of tug-of-war, a pin is pulled which activates the winch, slowly pulling both chains towards the center. I checked with some friends in the winching industry, and they confirmed for me that this is mostly a lot of dressing. Probably to prevent the victims from getting too friendly with the mechanics of the machine. A lot of the parts here resemble what we see utilized from the rack in Saw 3, so we can count these as scavenged and brought to this location. However, that pin power inhibitor, a little trick that comes up a lot in this movie, is going to cost around $45. We can also charge our standard old lock and key prices. Those collars are made out of new materials, shockingly, while the chains remain scavenged. The motor is also going to cost Jigsaw around $100, per usual, and the mood lighting and related electronics inside the winch itself will run about $40. And although it's not revealed until later, there's also a microcassette recorder and cassette present in the area for the survivor. We'll charge for a 10-pack and add it to the tally. Down in the sewers, Gotham's finest have located Detective Carey's tomb, but it's guarded by an ancient Egyptian curse, a pipe bomb. Given that this bomb is set to blow if somebody opens the door, we can charge for the electronics at least. Rigg is boldly charging forward, Hoffman's warnings be damned. Not sure if they disarmed the pipe bomb for him to do that, or if there was a different, less bombful entrance. Regardless, R2-D2 finds Detective Carey and Rigg gets scolded.
You know never to go through an unsecured door, ever.
But what's this? The FBI finally caught up to my search history and appeared on the scene. Agents Strahm and Perez are here to do what Hoffman's boys in blue couldn't. Catch Jigsaw. Back at the office, Rigg is revisiting his John Kramer research when it's suggested that he go home and spend some time with his wife. Maybe finish that renovation. He's kinda giving the office bad vibes.
Everyone around him keeps dying.
At home, Rigg finds his wife is planning a little vacation. She was definitely planning on taking him with her. Totally. There's a plane ticket in that envelope, right? I guess not. Agents Perez and Strahm start reviewing the Jigsaw case, catching up on Jill Tuck's interview. Hoffman stops by for a quick visit. Oh, that's cute. He's on stuffy delivery. What a nice guy. Unfortunately, he gets kidnapped for being so damn handsome all the time. Rigg decides to relax a little bit, with some light wrestling and a shower. Looks like someone's taking a whack at his renovation project as well. A wire on his doorknob activates another pin power inhibitor, which begins a broadcast straight into his TV, introducing him to his new self-help series hosted by Billy the Puppet.
Hello, Officer Rigg. Welcome to your rebirth.
Rigg's hallway has been dressed up with the photos of friends, and someone's even stopped by to sit and watch the telly. Rigg, ever the cautious and careful cop, does not in fact see what Jigsaw sees, and instead rips the pig shawl off the woman, activating her scalping chair, or as I call it, the lazy boy. To release the victim, Rigg needs to find all the numbers on the gears and enter them into the safe lock on the side, as she explains.
They're in the gears!
What's in the gears?
However, Rigg hears shoot the gears and does so. Alright, let's break down what we've got here. First up is paint on the door and throughout the house. Easy peasy. Next up is the steel cable on the doorknob. We'll allot a single purchase for the film, running over to another power pin inhibitor. There's also a live feed receiver hooked up to the TV in the bedroom. Leaving the room is a big honkin' timer with another pin power inhibitor. We're gonna see a bunch of both of these throughout the film, and the timers are all seemingly synchronized. Apparently, this is a thing you can do with some minimal work, so that's fine, rack it up. Then we get to the hallway of surveilled delinquents. So, we know from the first Saw film that the cost of a PI to trail someone and provide photos is about $1,000. That going rate was a week of stalking, a single subject. We've got four subjects here, assuming a week spent on each. That's $4,000 worth of stalking. Adam is definitely paying his rent this month. I'll also charge for all the photo hooks that show up in the movie. And yeah, there's quite a few of them. In the TV den, we get to the good stuff. The pig mask is arts and crafts, no charge. The fabric is fresh and comes up later, so we'll charge for it now. The work light that pops on isn't visible in the room previously, so we'll add it to the bill. I actually found one sold by Lowe's back in 2006 for about $63. The TV pops on, that's another live feed receiver. Another timer in the room lets everyone know how much time is left in the movie. And finally, the victim, Brenda, is chained in place. I can't tell if she's actually able to sit or if she's forced into a squatting position, but she's chained with what are new chains. We can charge for 15 feet and that should cover this and other chain of this type we see later on. In Brenda's hand is a microcassette player, a microcassette, and electrical tape to hold it all in place. Another power inhibitor starts the motor on the lazy boy, with some cold cathode ray tubes lighting up the guts of the device. How do I know those are cold cathode ray tubes? Because I put those same lights in my computer a century ago when this movie came out. They're cheap, they're cold, they are not at all RGB. They probably cause cancer though. There's also a dial from a safe, and it looks like the box houses the entire lock mechanism. You can actually purchase these separately from a safe, so we'll add that to the count. The rest of the machinery could be sourced from a meatpacking plant, and thus does not get charged. Finally, Brenda is secured with these leather restraints that match the kind one might find in an abandoned asylum. A five-finger discount later, and we have the lazy boy chair calculated. Rigg is quick on the draw, but slow on the solve, so Brenda only gets half scalped before being set free. While Rigg goes looking for a napkin, Brenda opens the small cabinet to reveal a tucked away light and a knife. The short sword is free, though it is magically enchanted. It does 1d4 plus 1 damage and turns mirrors into police stations.
The princess came in from Officer Rigg.
The cops don't notice Rigg finding out that Brenda was actually a horrible person, and Rigg is off to his next adventure. The agents do notice the UV paint that Jigsaw hid on the walls, and will add that to the bill. The paint reveals a connection: Jill Tuck, Jigsaw's widow, currently doctoring doctor stuff. And so begins round two of Jill Tuck being questioned about her marriage to murder bachelor number one. Hey, cool necklace, Jill. Somewhere in the Matrix, Hoffman and Matthews are being held captive. Hoffman looks great as always, but Matthews looks like an unmasked member of Slipknot at the end of a very long tour. So this trap is interesting. Matthews is suspended by the neck onto a block of ice. As the ice melts, the seesaw fills with water. If too much water pools under Hoffman, or if Matthews slips off the block, Hoffman gets electrocuted. I'll save calculating this trap room for last because it is wild. Besides, just as we start to get settled, we're brought to the Heartbreak Hotel where Rigg has to face his next challenge. Upon arriving at the hotel, Rigg is given a gift: a pig mask, a micro cassette recorder, and an illuminated photo of the clerk downstairs. Rigg is also given a challenge: do as the Jig saws.
Hello, Officer Rigg. In order for you to fully understand my way, you must feel what I feel.
Casting speak with animal, Rigg lures the very good boy upstairs, whose absence lures the very bad man upstairs as well, and Rigg invites him inside. Back at the station, Jill's interview is going really well. Strahm's flabbergasted interrogation methods send us into a flashback, revealing John, the man behind the saw. Strahm has no sympathy for rehabilitation. He prefers condescending intimidation.
But you know what the best part is? I don't have to convince everybody. Just 12 people.
This unlocks another memory of John's workshop, where he intends to cure time, I guess? Oh, there's also a proto-Billy there too. Don't worry, happy memories are free of charge. Returning to the hotel, Rigg is still trying to figure out how this whole jigsaw thing works. Opening the adjacent door, we're treated to a PowerPoint presentation of perversion. This is Ivan's game, and Rigg is the referee. Ivan is tasked with laying down on the bed and securing himself. He's given two switches which will activate a machine to blind him. If he doesn't take the plunge in time, his limbs pop off faster than a Mr. Potato Head hitting the floor. Before we see how well he quarters, let's assess the room. There's another receiver for the live feed of Matthews and Hoffman, as well as another microcassette recorder and tape. There's actually another microcassette recorder and tape that activates a switch that opens a drawer, which is cool. The room is lit by what I think are 7 red lights? We'll go with that, sure. The restraints are asylum grade, and the hardware for the 4-poster bed looks to be the same materials from the meatpacking plant. Quite a lot of decor for this red room of pain. Also, the timer used for this trap and the Lazy Boy chair is the same timer used in the reverse bear trap. That's neat. So, let's see how Ivan's— oh no. Ooh. The 4 iron catapults catapult his limbs off, and Rigg is sent back to school for his next assignment. In a flashback, we're shown Rigg talking to a child who might have been abused by the very definition of a shit-eating bastard man. Rigg agrees and decks his halls onto the walls. Unfortunately, police brutality with witnesses does not bode well in the Sauniverse. Jill's interrogation continues, though she's particularly unimpressed with Strahm's work. I guess being married to Jigsaw, you learn a thing or two about poker faces. In another flashback, we're reintroduced to Addison from Saw 2. Or I guess, introduced for the first time again. Wait, was this why she got trapped? Jesus, John, just say no thank you and move on.
You're a beautiful girl, go home.
Anyway, John finds out that Cecil canceled his kid, so he decides to try his hand at car stunts and gets cancer. Thus, his life coach origin story is complete. One window transition later, and we're back into Strahm's ever-open arms. Mr. Potato Head has been pulled off the bed. That's bad forensics. But the FBI is closing in on Rigg and his games. A tip takes them down to the basement, where they're given a warning and a lesson in CCTV. Matthews decides to take the plunge, and we're shown just how precariously his and Hoffman's lives are held in the balance. Hoffman recognizes their captor as the lawyer representing Father of the Year, Rex. Unfortunately, this blue-toned Saul Goodman knows the law, and knows that police brutality means his client gets off and screws the department on the way out. Rigg arrives at school, and it's looking worse for wear. This is the same school we saw in the last film, as you can see the police tape door over there. Once again, the power is left on. That's cool. And hey, the guy chained up is Rex. Oh, and that's his wife Morgan, and Jesus, she's still alive. Oh, she says she's won. Oh, good.
I won!
What the hell did you do?
We're taken back to the game that she just played. Several spikes link her vascular system to her husband's. She can free herself at the cost of his life. Will she finally leave this piece of shit? Let's tally up the cost of what I call the divorce trap. When Rigg walks into the room, there's some nice accent lights that I definitely don't remember having in school. We've also got a timer and a security camera. Those might be more standard now, but they definitely weren't in 2006. The lovely couple are chained and harnessed to a pole in the middle of the room. We could say the chains were locally sourced, and the harness came from the asylum, but the chain holding the microcassette player and tape in her hand is definitely purchased. By the way, some people seem to miss at my decision to let chains be locally sourced from a school. Guys, I'm from Texas. All our schools had chains. Cheap guns, plentiful chains, no income tax. It's basically heaven if you love hell. Anyway, the two are entwined with what are either 4 foot long or 2 foot long spikes, depending on what angle you're looking at. This does confuse things a bit in regard to pricing the spikes, whether they're javelins or specialized spears or crossbow bolts or hay bale spikes. They seem to range around $50 each in 2006. However, because they could theoretically be pulled from school property or the meatpacking plant, I'll let them slide. Much like how they slide right out of those wounds. Smooth as butter. Rigg is treated to the survival story of the toughest divorcee this side of Jill Tuck, and finds his own microcassette recorder and tape. Another clue tells Rigg where to go, but we're gonna stick around just a little bit longer because there's a few more things to count in the room. Mulder and Scully are back on the scene to solve the divorce puzzle. The city's finest are dusting a pneumatic spear gun looking device for Prince and end up setting it off. So this is a neat machine. It's got the upper rail of an AR-15, but parts from a spear gun, and we get a semi-decent look at the kinds of spikes used in the trap, length notwithstanding. We can estimate the price of these parts and the air compressor system to make it run to cost around $360 total. Strahm McClunky's Perez out of the way, and the forensics photographer takes the hit. Catching their breath, Strahm and Perez make their way to the OFBICE. Looks like Billy was trying to seduce his secretary, but caught the attention of the FBI instead. In this room, we can charge for a new Billy, Billy's microcassette recorder and tape, all those sexy candles, and the motor to let Billy look around. Oh, and Billy's headache. What headache? That headache. From the school, we return to the playground, where Matthews is being tricksy with the seesaw. Gonna need you to cool off, kiddo. There's still 20 minutes in this film. Art shakes things up by giving Matthews the revolver and bullet. What might be going on there, huh? Strahm is grieving his lack of protocol, but is finally putting the pieces together. Kinda. At least he's learning to ask questions.
What's with the dog?
What's with the tricycle?
Who were John's business associates before he went insane?
Look, he's had a rough first day. In another flashback, we're introduced to a John that's beginning to spiral. Art and Jill visit John at his workshop, but he's not building toys for all the girls and boys. No, he's been building traps for all the scum and rats. John politely excuses the mess and lets Art and Jill see themselves out.
Get the fuck out of here.
The next time Jill saw John, he was preparing for his first target, Cecil. We see how John makes his tapes, and we see him stalking his kill. Some chloroform does the trick, and Cecil wakes up in a special chair. Cecil has to push his face through knives in order to escape his little prison. He seems pretty determined, but ultimately, John sucks at building chairs. Cecil breaks free and turbocharges straight into a crib full of razor wire. Yikes. Cecil's trap consists of some light stalking, chloroform, and fresh razor wire. Did you know you can just buy chloroform? What the fuck? While John considers where to invest his skill points, he unsheathes a preview of coming attractions. The glass coffin. So, there's a deleted scene regarding this coffin. That homeless guy at the entrance to the hotel was originally supposed to be locked in there, but the MPAA said digging around in glass was simply too much for audiences. Aight, sure. The coffin does get play later on in the series though, so that's awesome. So, do we charge for the coffin because it's here in the past and had an intended subject? Or do we wait until it comes into play later? Valid arguments could be made for both, but I'm going to hold off until you see the coffin used in its full glory. Unlike the birdcage trap, the glass coffin has a big role to play. It has a home in the next film. Anyway, John kills time with Jill and we're thrust back into the present. Rigg has found his final destination, whatever that means.
What the fuck does that mean?
And we're beginning to see just what's in store for Matthews should this game fail. Oh boy. But no, not yet, because Strahm is also pulling up, and he's pissed as hell. Another timer greets Rigg as he makes his way down the Hall of Indoctrination. Eric Matthews and Dark Hoffman's badges invite him deeper, while Strahm discovers, are those Jeff's keys? Huh. And back in the Seesaw room, Art's participation is explained a bit more clearly. He's got a wicked device waiting to sever his spine, I guess. It looks like he could just duck to avoid it, but what do I know? Anyway, that'll cost $145 in motors and electronics. Rigg, Strahm, and Jeff stalk the halls. Wait, Jeff, what are you doing here? Let you out, sneaky boy. Strahm seems to be tracking Jeff's angst, while Rigg sprints to the finish. There's only seconds left on the clock. Jeff is once again locked inside the surgery room for the first time, Strahm following closely behind. Art arms himself with a switch to release everyone once the timer hits zero, but Rigg can't wait any longer. He bursts into the room, Matthew shoots him, and we can now calculate the cost of the seesaw trap! Just as Rigg was planning to burst in, he passed a timer in the hall. He comes upon quite a scene. Matthews is perched on a slippery block of ice. When the door is opened before the timer runs out, two more blocks of ice will do something super cool to his head. The block that Matthews has been hanging out on is, by my estimation, a standard 300-pound block. The other two in the ceiling look to be the same dimensions as that 300-pound block when combined, so we'll tally that up. Each of these blocks goes for around $100, so $200 for two blocks. We've got two heat lamps pointed at the blocks of ice, inconveniently melting it and trying to fuck up Hoffman's night. Silly as it may seem, we've also got a lot of decorative lighting. Factories don't come with ellipsoidal spotlights, and yours truly dove deep to find the prices of such lights in the year 2006. As it turns out, it's about $250 each. Jigsaw, ever the diva, has hooked up 10 lights by my count, resulting in $2,500 in lighting. As for our sweet boy Hoffman, his bindings have some electronics wired up to the back of his neck. The fabric in his mouth matches the fabric we've seen throughout the film. For the rest of the room, we have a timer above the door inside and outside, as well as one by Art's desk. A pin power inhibitor sits above the door, waiting to do something super cool, I'm sure. Art's security system consists of a 6-monitor CCTV broadcasting setup. Two desktops in that bunch, with a camera in the room pointed at Matthews and Hoffman. Finally, we have Art's gun, and he's got a microcassette player and tape on him as well. Oh, and there's some neato desk LEDs, add those in. So let's rewind a bit and see how this goes. Okay, Rigg can't wait any longer, bursting into the room. Matthews, in a last-ditch effort to stop him, shoots. Rigg, feeling spicy, shoots Art. The arms above Matthews release, and... Oh, that's also bad news for Hoffman. Man, that sucks. I wanted to see more of him. Meanwhile, Strahm doesn't know how doors work. Thankfully, Jigsaw taught him about keys. He bursts in and, oh, fuck, he kills Jeff. Dude! Glad someone did. Art tries to pass a message on to Rigg, but Rigg is just too trigger happy and shoots him. The tape rolls as Rigg is seriously reconsidering his life choices.
Time was on your side, but your obsession wouldn't let you wait.
How can this get any worse for him? Except, wait, Hoffman is standing over him, totally not electrocuted. In fact, Hoffman was in on the whole crazy night. Rigg's game was rigged. Oh, And if you had any doubts, remember when Hoffman was taking that stuffy to a girl? Yeah, that's the same stuffed animal we see with Jeff's daughter when Jigsaw reveals she's been kidnapped. And yeah, that means we've got one last charge for a stuffed animal. Hoffman looms large, and poignant words leave those perfect lips.
Game over.
Hoffman leaves Rigg to bleed out, crossing the plant and sealing Strahm in his tomb. Locking the door, he leaves, Jigsaw's final words playing into the autopsy room.
The games have just begun.
And with that, Saw 4 is complete in all its chiller font glory. A Shakespearean tragedy of treachery, misdirection, and continued cop-on-cop violence. With a new secret apprentice in the works, and the other side of Jigsaw's final night now past us, how did John fare? Did he dig an even deeper hole for his estate to try and bail out of? Or did he thread the financial needle and come in under budget? Let's add it up. In total, Jigsaw spent $12,650.50 on his traps, surveillance, and an ungodly number of timers and microcassette players. That's just over $19,000 in today's money. Man, I thought the last movie was bad. There are a total of 9 microcassette players and tapes in this film. That almost blew through the 10-pack of tapes I allotted him. There were also 7 timers synchronized across the events of the evening, and the most surveillance ever undertaken by Jigsaw, with nearly half the budget going to just paying Adam for photos. The most expensive trap was technically the Lazy Boy trap, with a total of $4,928. If we exclude the surveillance decor, however, then the most expensive trap becomes, unsurprisingly, the Seesaw trap. Again, mostly due to decoration. Everything to set the mood, eh, John? The cheapest trap was Art's back scratcher at $145, followed by the Lady and the Tramp trap at $280. Funny that both of those should target the lawyer. With Jigsaw dead, officially, let's see how much he spent across the first act of the Saw franchise. John Kramer has spent a total of $141,854.01 on locks, tapes, guns, and home renovation. At this point in the franchise, Jigsaw is well and dead. But given what we now know, a man who made it to the cover of magazines, a highly successful and philanthropic civil engineer, could he cover the costs? Well, historic data tells us that a civil engineer in the United States made, on average, $80,000 a year working for the federal government in 2006. You can expect that salary to increase in the private sector. We get the sense that Jigsaw was quite prestigious in his field, likely had diversified his sources of income by the time the events of the first Saw even took place. It's also not unreasonable that he and Jill were setting up a nest egg for their kiddo. While it might have wiped out the remainder of his savings after divorcing Jill, it's safe to say that John Kramer could absolutely foot the bill for the first 4 Saw films. But the work is not over. As we well know, Saw 5 is yet to come. Who is Detective Hoffman? What's up with Jill's cool necklace? What other nonsensical flashbacks will disrupt all of these calculations I've done? Tune in and find out on the next Foot the Bill. Guys, I'm so glad y'all keep turning out for these videos. Next up, we've got Saw 5, Now You See Me, and a special surprise video in the works, a new franchise, and this one can get a little cheesy at times. More on that soon. As always, thank you so much to my network of experts in all their fields, thank you to my editor, my wife, and thank you to all of you who tune in. Special shout out to Patreon members who make sure I can churn out these videos every month. I'll see y'all in the next one. I'm here to make stuff, if you're here to watch.